Hello friends, how are you today? I hope you're all doing well, safe and healthy. Even though we were just having difficult time because of the passing of Reverend Stephen Suliman, who is very active or who was very active in our Sunday worship service. And we want to remember Stephen Suliman and his great contribution to this worship service. So let us take a moment of silence before we begin this worship to remember Pak Stephen's kindness, to remember Pak Stephen's presence among us. Let us take a moment of silence, very briefly, to ponder on God's kindness generated to us through Pak Stephen Suliman. May the generosity of the man of God be remembered. May his values be embodied by all of us. May his ministry, passion for justice, accompaniment with the marginalized, be emulated by each and every one of us as we continue to move forward in our lives. Let us begin this worship by singing our first song, Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord.
Oh yeah. See things for the way they really are. Open our eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. I want to see.
Lift it up. Let me hear you.
Open the eyes of my heart. Holy, 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 I want to see.
lifted up.
Holy, holy.
May the Lord be in our listening. May the Lord be in our understanding. May the Lord be in our practicing of the Word of God. Amen. Our reading today is going to be pretty short, taken from John chapter 18, verses 33 through 37. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." This is the word of the Lord. Friends, when we read the Bible, we sometimes become accustomed to biblical texts. And when we come across this part, we many times lose sense of how strange this conversation is. How baffling, how confusing, you know. Or perhaps this is like a conversation between a person who is, of course, having this world as their habitus, right? Who is from this world, a human being and a superhuman being, or a transhuman being, transcendent human being, right? Or a person or whatever being coming from another dimension, coming from one of the planets perhaps, right? Coming from Mars or Jupiter, right? This is like Thor having a conversation with a human being, right? Saying that he's the son of Asgard, or he's from Asgard, the son of, I have to check what's his father's name. Please drop your comment on the YouTube comment section. No, I'm joking. Aiden, son of Aiden. Oh my gosh, I watch Marvel movies a lot, but I forget Thor's father's name. But anyway, yeah, it's like Thor saying that he's son of Aiden and he's from Asgard, right? Somewhere over the rainbow, above the skies. And then, of course, people here are confounded. They're, you know, having difficulty trying to process that in mind. What do you mean by that? What do you mean by the kingdom is not from here? What do you mean by saying that the kingdom is from above or from there, not here? So this is a very strange conversation. This is an uncanny exchange, you know, and very confusing as well. And some people could or might also laugh at this, you know, at this scene if they were there watching Pilate and Jesus talking. They would accuse Jesus of being a mad man, you know, like when we heard of the fake empires, right? The news was very big before the pandemic. Empires that claim to control the world. They claim that they have control of the world, but then they're actually non-existent. So it's pretty much like that, right? But here we can see two different notions of kingdom or kingship. Pilate, who is a high-ranking official within the Roman Empire, being tasked as a governor in the region, of course, hold the understanding of a kingdom that is marked by its capacity to conquer. A kingdom is marked by its capacity to rule and to have dominance over the territory it rules. And it has to rule over a vast territory to be recognized as a mighty kingdom or as a powerful kingdom. If the kingdom does not encompass a large amount of land or several continents, right? Then the kingdom is considered a small kingdom, an insignificant kingdom. A kingdom is also a mighty kingdom is also marked by its strong military, right? Marked by strong, undefeated defense system. And that is the imagination of kingdom that lives up in Pilate's mind. But then we see here, when Pilate confronts Jesus, Jesus seems to have a different understanding of a kingdom. So if the Roman Empire's understanding of a kingdom, which it, you know, lives on and proven to be successful in expanding the range of its territory and also of its influence, Jesus has a somewhat different, or not only different but contradictory, understanding of kingdom, which actually violate all the criteria of kingdom upheld by the Roman Empire. The characteristics of kingdom that is understood by Pontius Pilate. Jesus has a starkly different understanding. Completely the other way around. It's like the opposite of the understanding of kingdom by Pontius Pilate. So Jesus says here that his kingdom is not from the world. And that means Jesus distinguishes his kingdom from this world. Jesus does not share with the world the understanding of kingdom and kingship. That means the understanding differs completely when the Roman Empire understands kingdom as characterized by its capacity or capability to dominate, to control, to subjugate, to have dominion over a vast area. Jesus somehow has a different view. By saying his kingdom is not from the world, he does not, or he refuses to identify himself with the worldly definition of kingdom. He says this kingdom is from there. So his understanding of kingdom does not fit in the world's, or at least in Romans' understanding of kingdom. If the Roman Empire understands kingdom as characterized by its capacity to rule, Jesus has a different opinion. My friends, throughout our Bible, we find so many contestations between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of human beings. Within the theological study, we learn theology of liberation, which basically believes that God's mission is to liberate people from everything that oppresses them. And they make references to the story of Exodus, when Moses brings out the Israelites from Egypt, when Moses frees the slaves, the Israelites, from the slavery in Egypt. And that is also indicative of a clash between two kingdoms. The kingdom of God that wants to bring liberation, the kingdom of God that wants to liberate, versus the kingdom of human beings who is always tempted to oppress, to subjugate, to subdue, to control. But Jesus is not like that. Jesus comes to liberate. God comes to free you, to rescue you, and also to empower you to do great things. Not like the kingdom of human beings that puts you in a lower position, that does not empower you, that wants only to rule you, to rule over you. But the kingdom of God brings liberation. The kingdom of God brings empowerment. The kingdom of God brings accompaniment. The kingdom of God accompanies those who are unwanted. Jesus is always present with those who are not counted as important person in the society. Jesus mingles with the sinners. Jesus mingles with the sick. Jesus mingles with those subsumed under the low-level leak category, or not even a leak actually, but just a bunch of people with their ailments, with their physical conditions believed to be the consequences of the wrongdoings of their past wrongdoings of their ancestors. So that is the definition of kingdom according to Jesus, marked by presence, marked by accompaniment, marked by love and a passion for justice, a passion for peace. My friends, we just lost Reverend Stephen Suleiman, who passed away last week. And he was a true example of accompaniment and presence with those who are unlikely, those we consider sinful, with the marginalized. Pat Stephen was present with the sexual minorities. Pat Stephen was present with even minority groups within other religions. He was also there to advocate on their behalf. Pat Stephen also joined the struggle of the GKI Yasmin congregation to fight for justice so that the building that is theirs can be theirs again. The building they used to worship God in become theirs again. And many other endeavors, many other commendable causes. So, my friends, this is an example of what a Christian life should be like. A Christian life should be determined by one's being with others, by one's presence with others. Not an egocentric, self-glorifying proclivity, but being with others. That is the most important thing in a Christian life. So let us ponder on this Bible text. Let us ponder on God's accompaniment manifested in the accompaniment of many people of God, including Pat Stephen, in our lives. So let us also pray that God will give us the ability to model Jesus' ministry and to model Jesus' understanding of kingdom. That Jesus' understanding of kingdom is not determined by the things that glorify him only, but also by his presence, his identification, his accompaniment with the marginalized. May God bless you and God be with you. Friends, if you'd like to give offerings to the church, you may do so by transferring it to GKI Gading Indah bank account. Now, in closing our service today, let us sing our closing song, The Kingdom of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your accompaniment. We pray that we can be agents of peace and justice. We pray that we can align ourselves with the kingdom values, not the values of the worldly kingdoms, but the values of the kingdom of God, so that we can emulate God's presence with the marginalized and the poor. Give us the strength, give us the courage and ability so that this does not end as mere slogans, but manifest in our lives truly. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Have a blessed Sunday, everyone. God bless you.